Okay. I'd like to again welcome everyone, thanking you for taking time out of your busy schedule to support us. Our evening is being presented by our firm, law firm, Shemento Sellis & Dwyer, along with participation of our title company, Pioneer Title. When I was thinking about what I would like to do as a result of some significant changes that were going to be coming down affecting our real estate industry, and it's something that's near and dear to my heart because I've been at it for well over 40 years, it dawned on me that I'm a businessman, and to get the message out from a promotional point of view, and we're here to promote our law firm and our title company, but to get the message out, it dawned on me that I need to be talking and dealing with similarly situated business owners. And that's where we came up with the idea of this broker's symposium. It's your business. It's not your agent's business. Sometimes you question if that's the case, but it's your business. And it's an opportunity for you to educate yourself and take control. Because as we say, it ain't over till the fat lady sings. Now, maybe that might not be appropriate to say, but it ain't over until we get the closing. And that's what it's all about, because you guys are the bottom line. You guys sign the checks, and you guys get paid last. So this is an opportunity to indoctrinate you, to educate you, and bring to you what I think is some timely information about some significant changes that are going on in our industry and that are going to have some significant effects on the timeliness of your closing and getting that commission check. As I said, it's myself from the law firm, and I just briefly want to introduce Laura Leonardo. Many of you know, is with our title company, Pioneer Title. Kelly DeVore, also with the law firm and Pioneer. Michelle Heiser, who is our office manager of the company, many of you know. And then real happy to have with us Jay St. Lawrence, right down here. Jay is an attorney. Jay is a vice president with our major title underwriter, Attorneys Title Services, the Orlando, that are statewide, but they're in Orlando, and have been very integral in getting the information out to its agents, myself, our firm, and our title company across the state. So I wanted to invite him to participate also. You know, as I said, it's your business, not your agent's business. And shame on you if you don't take the time to educate yourself and know what's coming down the road. Now, a little housekeeping real quick, and that's the operative word, real quick. It's a long day. We've all been working. The last thing we want to do is get involved or sit through some long, drawn-out, dry presentations. I've told everybody on our panel tonight, we want to make it short and quick. We're just going to touch and give you an overview so that when you leave here, you have some red flags waving. And if we can help you or come to your office and meet with you and your sales agent to fill you in on the details, we'd be glad to do so. As you can see, we're taping this presentation. We've done a similar presentation at various functions at the Board of Realtors and with the Women's Committee Board of Realtors. We found it very successful to tape this on a videotape so that we will have it available to you should you like to present it to your salespeople at some sales meeting, or have it available in your office for them to come by when it's convenient for them to sit and listen to the thing. And we're trying to hold it timely to a short period of time for that reason. It was billed as a symposium, whatever that means, but in my mind, we're going to talk about some issues, but then really the crux of it is the Q&A. I'd ask that you hold your questions and answers till the end, but I would like to engage in a professional discussion, encouraging you for questions between our staff, who we've been diligently working on this since, I guess, the beginning of the year, knowing this was coming down. And that's the whole theme of what we're talking about, changes. So I'm going to get started. I was curious, before I do, I was curious, and maybe Jay can comment on it. I've been to many, and also our staff have been to, thanks. Been to a number of presentations at various times throughout the year here, and I'm just throwing this out, and we can talk about it later. But it seems like the bar, Florida Bar, and it seems like our title underwriters are on the cutting edge of what we're going to be talking about tonight. But I haven't seen a lot coming down from your the Florida Realtors Association in terms of marching this information out and educating you all. So I'd be curious to hear from you in that regard. So to get started, I'm going to introduce to you Jay Lawrence. As I said, he's vice president with Attorneys Title Services in Orlando. And I asked Jay if he would just give you a brief overview of Dodd-Frank, a brief overview of what's called the CFPB. These are acronyms you're going to have to learn. That's called the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau. You've been probably reading about it for the past couple years in the newspaper, never dreaming in a million years that it had any impact or effect on you, but it does. So he's going to talk about just a brief overview of that. Then he's going to talk about a brief overview of what we call the integrated disclosure rules that you're going to now become familiar with. And he's going to talk very briefly on how that impacts your closings. And that's what we're here about tonight. Jay?
No, I'm good. Thanks, Mike. I appreciate it. It's nice to be here. As noted, I'm John St. Lawrence. People call me Jay. I'm a legal education attorney with the fund. I am not yet a vice president, but if you would call Maggie, and maybe put in a good word with Chuck Kovaleski, we can get me there. So we have been dealing with this, as you guys all have, with this change in the law, which is coming to us courtesy of the Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform Act, right? So this was the big law that Congress passed in 2009 in response to that market bubble and collapse that we all try not to remember, but it happened. So here comes Dodd-Frank, and the idea here was to regulate and reform with a particular focus on protecting consumers in the consumer mortgage context. So that's what all of this is about. The Dodd-Frank Act is not so much about commercial stuff, not so much about business dealings or agricultural loans. The CFPB in particular, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, is a new government regulatory body that came out of Dodd-Frank, and they are tasked with looking at all of this stuff, with streamlining rules that exist like TILA and RESPA, adding to them, enforcing them, and they're doing all that with gusto or a vengeance, depending on how you look at it. And they've done several different things, and they're sort of the new sheriff in town. Everybody's taking CFPB very seriously. They have a reputation already for using their authority. I think they actually get a little bit of their funding from fines and sanctions. So they're not too shy about that. And their fines and sanctions, by the way, are huge. One reason everybody is paying such close attention to everything they say is for a typical violation of something under either their new loan originator rule or this closing disclosure thing that we're talking about today. I think the fines start at $5,000 a day. It's $25,000 a day if they were deliberate, and $1 million a day if it was it's reckless and then willful. So it's five, 25, and then $1 million a day, and then anything else they can think of. They actually say that. No, they do talk about things like rescission, sending the money back, sending the property back. So they're very serious. And the new closing disclosure form is this. Your HUD-1, in the context of an ordinary residential mortgage transaction, is no more. Starting, it was going to be August 1st, right? They have recently announced that it's probably going to be October 1st instead, because it was an administrative error that happened, or maybe it was a head fake all along and they wanted to give people a little more time. But although that is not completely solidified, CFPB has said it will probably be October 1st. And the way the date works is loans originating, not closing, but originating on or after that date will be subject to this. This is the closing disclosure. It is very different from the HUD one that you're used to. The HUD one is not going away, by the way, completely. It's still gonna apply to certain things, reverse mortgages, HELOCs. There are certain instances where it's permissible but not required. But the CD, as they're calling it, comes to us through this regulatory change that CFPB is working on. Mike made some reference to the TRID rules, the TILA-RESPA Integrated Disclosure. That is the CFPB project to bring TILA and RESPA rules together. They used to be in two different parts of the federal rules we called Reg X and Reg Z. It's like 12 CFR 1026. Is Reg Z, and that's where they all are now. So part of what CFPB has done is streamline a little bit and put a lot of what we used to think of as the TILA and RESPA stuff all together in one place, and they've promulgated this new form. It's 5 pages. It's 13 in total because there are variations to the various pages that can be applicable in certain cases, and it's very different from HUD-1 in this way. The HUD-1 closing statement that everyone is so useful was kind of a little bit of a hybrid document, right? On the one hand, it was a closing statement. You had your two columns, all the money in, all the money out, everything you need for your deal. And then it was subject to certain disclosure rules under the federal regulations that had to be followed. The closing disclosure is a loan document. Let that sink in for a second. It's not a closing document. It's not concerned with your real estate purchase and the sale. It's a loan document. And as such, what we're seeing, due to the fact that the form is different, due to the fact that there are these high stakes in place if any of these disclosure rules are broken, what our lenders are telling us is that they are going to produce this form. Wells Fargo has said this formally. Citibank has said this. SunTrust has said this. Every lender that we're aware of that has said anything about how they're going to handle the closing disclosure has said, although, and this is worth noting, they can, under the law, delegate the creation of the closing disclosure to title agents, they will not be doing that. The closing agents have a document they'll be preparing, the seller's disclosure. They're still responsible, and the lenders are making this very clear too, for getting all the information together, for all the service providers, for all the fees that are owed to everyone. But the actual document itself is going to be generated probably via a third-party cloud-based software application by the lenders themselves. So that's going to be a little different, and it may be a little discomfiting in certain ways. People won't necessarily have the HUD-1 in their hands to carry around as kind of a concrete idea of the deal itself or representation. People may start using old school disclosure or closing statements, that kind of thing. We don't know. But it's a little different. And the lenders have kind of taken another step and said, furthermore, settlement agents, we're giving you guys a copy, but you can't share it with anybody without the express permission of the borrower. If you get that, you can share it, but they're not handing it around to everyone. I don't think the lenders are visualizing this as being the document that gets passed around the closing table anymore. Doesn't even have a place for the seller or the settlement agent to sign. It's a borrower document. So things are going to change. Things are going to change in that way. As far as the impact is going to have on closings, a lot of it is going to be wait and see. We're going to have to see how this impacts the way people handle things. Is there going to be a closing statement? There is a place for everybody's fees and commissions. You're going to want to focus on table H other, which is on page 2. Those are non-loan required fees and costs. That is where things like commissions are going to go. One thing to note, because the lenders are going to be producing this form, there may be a different process where it may be a little bit more difficult to get it amended or changed. One of the new rules is that in some instances where the initial CD and a number of others, depending on what happens, have a three-day requirement, a three-day lead time before closing. So the first one's going to definitely have to get to the borrowers 3 days out. Most lenders are saying they're going to make it 6 days so they can mail it and rely on something called the mailbox rule. Subsequent closing disclosures, because they will be corrected, because that always happens, right? Don't necessarily have that 3 days. You only add the 3 days on again if it's an APR change, or if the loan product changes, if it goes from a fixed to a variable or something like that, or if they add a prepayment penalty. Other than that, CDs can just go lickety-split. They can generate them however fast they're willing to make adjustments. And CFPB has given us a few clues as to how they're going to handle some of this stuff. For instance, they don't put anything in writing, by the way. CFPB lawyers are getting asked a lot of questions because of these changes, and they're going around to symposia around the country and also answering emails and phone calls. But one of the things they've said is ask for certain types of common small changes, like a change on a walkthrough because the refrigerator wasn't there, or a small change to a commission, a typo. They have said expressly, hey, that's not going to be subject to the three-day thing. You know that, right? So I guess that's small comfort, but it's some comfort. But it's going to be a little different than being able to walk into your settlement agent's office and saying, hey, make me a new one. They're not going to really be able to do that anymore. They're going to have to get on their computer and probably log in with a piece of software called Closing Insight or one of a number of other pieces of similar software and tell the lender, hey, I've got a change. I've got a fee change. I've got a cost change. Spit out another one. And we'll have to see how fast they are about that. But everything is probably going to have a little bit more lead time, at least until it starts going. The lenders are asking settlement agents to get all their fees together 10 to 14 calendar days before closing. Now, on the other side, they have said, don't expect your closing package any earlier than you've been getting it. So that's still gonna land on the doorstep 5 minutes before closing or whatever. But so the process is gonna change. The responsibility for the form and how that's handled is going to change. But I think things are going to occur. People are still going to do closings. Nobody so far has concluded that this is going to, change business or eliminate settlement agents or anything like that. So we're gonna proceed. You're gonna be proceeding with a different form that looks like this. And I guess the takeaway for now is that this is going to be a lender-generated form, and that's probably going to impact things like lead times. And you're going to want to make sure your settlement agent is well-versed in how all this stuff works to make sure that they are ready, that they know how to handle this and work with their lenders to get these things issued and dealt with within the rules so that they can go ahead and keep closing. Good enough? All right. Sure. Thank you.
We'll have questions, like I said.
And, yeah, whenever you want, any kind of Q&A would be great.
Really, the bottom line to everything that Jay was saying is it's not business as usual. And now it puts a tremendous burden and responsibility on your closing agents. And it starts in your office, and that's what you need to be aware of, with your agents, compiling the information necessary for the to give to the closing agent to get that we would normally put on the HUD. Expenses, inspection fees, whatever the case may be. So it starts in your office, and you need to be aware of critical time level. It starts then with the title, the agents, as Jay said. We have to get this information 10 to 14 days ahead, minimum, ahead of closing. They in turn have to mail this out 3 days prior. And then there's another 3 days review time. So you can see what this adds to the orderly closing process. You've all been to the table or all got that call from your closing agent and said the lender hasn't given us the package. And we all know what that means. And then you got pissed off buyers and sellers. And who are they pissed off at? They're pissed off at you. But it's not your fault. And it's not the closing agent's fault. Well, now there is going to be accountability, because it's not so much that they haven't gotten the package, but they're not going to allow the closing agents to close unless they've met that 3-day advance disclosure. And if it doesn't, then it starts all over again. And that's where you and your agents are going to have a nice time trying to explain it, particularly to your seller. I'll say this also. The seller has nothing, they're the forgotten person in this. The CFBP, they could care less about the seller. This is, as he said, a loan document. Also, we cannot give you copies of that, because it's a loan document, it's a violation of privacy. One thing that you should consider is incorporating into your listing agreement or by letter to both seller and buyer the authority to provide you and to disclose these documents, or the HUD integrated disclosure documents to you. So keep that in mind. Whole new ball game. Okay, I want to move along. Next, I'm going to ask Michelle, if she could come up, and very briefly, if you don't have this package in front of you, we got extras, but I would ask you to follow through and just keep a track of that. Michelle's going to talk to you very briefly on 5 things that real estate agents, that's you, need to know before August 1/now October 1. This date, believe it or not, was just changed last week on us.
Hi everyone, I'm going to go ahead and just give you a brief overview of 5 things that real estate agents need to know before October 1st now. You know, we've talked about all the changes that are in the industry, how it's going to affect the closing agent, how it's going to affect the mortgage company, but what we really here are concerned about is how it's going to affect you as the broker and as the realtor. So we have a little disclosure in your package, it's number 2. And it just tells you the 5 things that you as a broker or as a realtor need to know regarding these changes. And the first one is the new loan estimate and closing disclosure. You're going to need to know how to explain those to your borrower if they have questions. And you're going to need authorization to even receive a copy of the closing disclosure to explain to the borrower. So that's going to be our first issue that we're going to have to address and overcome. Secondly, timing of closings are going to be impacted by this new closing disclosure rule, because the lenders are going to request invoices for the survey, for the home inspection, for the termite. We're going to need those 10 to 14 days in advance in order to provide those to the lender so that they can complete the closing disclosure. So we're not going to be able to do the last minute invoices, the last minute orders. It's everything's going to have to be done up front at the beginning of the closing process. The other difference is the title fees may need to be adjusted on the closing disclosure, because this is a loan document, it's not a seller document. They will more than likely be putting the lender's title premium as the full premium, with the owner's title policy as the simultaneous issue. Typically on the HUD we are using now, it's the owner's policy that has the full price with a $25, which is what Pioneer charges, simultaneous issue. So that is also going to change. So you'll probably see on page 3 of the new closing disclosure where there's an adjustment for that. So that'll be another thing that we'll have to explain to the borrower and the seller on the difference there. The other thing is there are no line items on the new closing disclosure. They have been removed. There are 7 sections only. So we won't be able to, when you call and have a question, say, well, look at line 1101. That's where your title is. Or look in the 800 section, that's where your commission is. There are no lines anymore, they are gone. So we'll have 7 sections. And last but not least, your client may likely receive more than one closing disclosure. It depends on how the loan is disclosed. It depends on if the APR changes. So that's another item that we may need to explain to them, because they'll get something up front, like they used to get a GFE, and a closing disclosure at the end. So there are a few things that you as brokers and realtors are going to need to be aware of and focus on to make this a seamless process. And if we all work together, I don't think it's going to be that bad. I think we can muddle through it, and I think we can get it done. And Pioneer is more than ready. We're educated, professional, and we are ready. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Michelle. As Michelle said, we've been preparing for this since February and March, knowing this was coming down. All the ladies have been to various seminars and webinars and are pursuing the education necessary technology-wise. They mentioned some insight that above my pay grade, but we now have to deal with portals. We can't pick up a phone and call a lender. And there's in the sky or in the cloud, whatever the hell they call it, portals and stuff that we have to deal with. But neither here nor there, they've worked very hard, and I'm very proud of them. One of the things that Jay mentioned about the CFPB, that is the agency under Dodd-Frank that is calling the shots on this, all of which, in my humble opinion, is a bunch of, it's an overkill and an overreaction to what happened a number of years ago. And what this is going to do to the closing process, in my opinion, it's just going to drag it out, confuse buyers and sellers to no end. But these are the bureaucrats that are doing this, and this is what we have to live with, because as Jay said, the fines are unbelievable. But one of the things that CFB did two years ago is they put out a mandate holds title companies to a higher, all vendors of banks to a higher standard, and requires the banks to vet their vendors, including title companies. And the title industry then, in reaction to that, put together what they call the ALTA best practices. I'm not going to steal Laura's thunder. I want her to talk to you a little bit about that, and talks about now the title companies are being vetted and have to be certified to be approved lenders. Laura?
Thank you, Mike. Hi, everyone. I'm Laura Leonardo Flynn, proud to be with Pioneer Title Services. And ALTA best practices. We were always held accountable in our industry to be professionals. So that part of it is nothing new. The presentation of this information was always made available to lenders at their request. For the most part, we were reviewed once a year as standard practice, and we would be notified when our package was due, and we would submit it. And it was a standard few pages just to justify the validity of our business, the fact that we were properly licensed, that we had our proper insurance, our errors and omissions, and that type of thing in place. Well, the best practices is somewhat a spin-off of that concept, but it has been taken to an extreme. As Mike was explaining, most of this has been. And it has now become quite an involved task, which I am proud to say that Pioneer Title has resolved. We undertook it and had it resolved by January 15th of 2014. The sad thing is not one person's wanted to see my manual. So I worked so hard on that manual, it's sitting there waiting. But I think our time is coming, because rumor has it that they are going to start reaching out. And we are proud to say that we have been prepared, and that in itself was a large undertaking. It's not that we weren't prepared previous, but we had these things in files, and we had these things available upon request, but we didn't have them readily made available to someone in a manual form, in a tabulated manual form. format, as well as having all the information available at any given time concerning all the licensed title agents that are working within our office. You are now going to see that licensed title agents are going to become the only people that can present your closing packages. They're going to be required to be the one that's handling that closing. And best practices manual does require the accountability of all people that are working on your in your office, as well as the fact that they must be licensed. It goes on to then identify the importance of these people being accountable to the industry and understanding the importance of the information that we're transferring back and forth and sharing within our office. And it goes on to dwell upon the security of the information and the protection of personal information of the consumer. And that in itself has become a very large task for most of us. This process is broken down into pillars. And the pillar most important and critical to be able to be in compliance with is the security protection. We are working diligently behind the scenes. There's many, many software packages that are out there now offering options in security and clouds and different types of things, cloud products that are offering us the availability of storing our information. We're all having to do upgrades, anybody in our industry, about the storage, the facilities, the type of storage, the lock and key, the fact that all of our offices have to be properly locked up and guarded with this information so that nobody can access it. Fortunately, we've all had good sense over the years, and we've always handled the information with sensitivity, but now it's become mandatory. So that's one more thing that your title companies are having to be accountable for. And in a quick wrap-up of the items that we now have to perform or make available, it's such as the licensing, like I talked about, our escrow trust account, we always have to be reconciled. That goes without saying. It's mandatory. There were years past regulations of the necessity of auditing and reconciling our accounts on a monthly basis. And so we are in compliance with all of that information, as well as recording practices. We do have recording rules and regulations within our office. And these best practices have forced us to become very structured. And it has forced us to address some of the things that we all take very nonchalantly. We know we have it covered within our office, but prove it kind of thing. And so we've had to step it up and make sure that all of our documentation is in one place for accountability. And we are proud to say that we have been managing to do that along the way. And one of the very, very, very important things nowadays is having a practice in place for a consumer complaint. And the practices that were followed within your office about a consumer filing a complaint, who will address that complaint, how is it handled, different levels of processing. So these are things that we've really had to take very seriously, along with the protection of that consumer's information. And so best practices is a very serious item. I'm sure you have very similar things in your industry, but when you hear a title company say that they're in compliance with ALTA best practices, it is a great accomplishment. It's something to be proud of, and it's nice to know that the title company you're working with is accountable. It's very important nowadays for title companies to take pride in the people that they have working for them, and very important that they check their credentials, their licensing. It's required that we all have proper licensing and continuing education, and this is going to be coming more and more of an issue in our industry, that everybody has to be accountable for the employees that they have on site and that are handling this personal sensitive information of the consumer. On the flip side of all of that, even though we are at that point providing evidence that we are accountable, the lenders have made a promise or an obligation to CFPB that they will work with service providers that are legitimate and service providers that are able to provide these necessities, one being in compliance with ALTA best practices. And we are now having to work at a pace of steadiness, but at a pace to be approved by all of these lenders to be sure that we are an approved service provider. And we have been working diligently to provide this information, similar to the information that's contained in our manual, to many levels of lenders, to lenders at one common level in some instances, to other lenders that are asking one-on-one for this information. There really is no consistency right now to the level and approach that we are having to take to get approved by lenders. And that is very important for you to know. Your title agencies, we're all doing this at a different pace. We're all doing this at a different way, in a different format. But it's important to know that your title agencies, all of us combined, will need to be approved for those lenders that are handling your borrower's loans. And so we at Pioneer Title are taking every option and opportunity to get approved by as many lenders as we possibly can up front before all this begins to roll out. And as I said, there's no consistency in the format or in the practice of what they're asking of us, but several of them have found a common ground of a software that's allowing us to register at that level, and it's allowing us to maybe, once we get approved at that level on that software, it then allows us to be approved by the Bank of Americas and the Wells Fargos and the TD Banks and that type of thing. They have not, unfortunately, all adopted the same practice. Some of them are not choosing to join forces with the big boys. Some of them are doing it at a much more lenient level. And process, probably because they don't have the staff involved to process all of these right away. So we are working at their pace, and we are working at their request of the documentation that's required. So I do want you to know that Pioneer Title is making every effort to be prepared to handle your closing with whomever your buyer's lender is. If you ever come across one that you think might be questionable as to whether or not a local title company would have even conceived the idea of getting approved for them, I highly recommend you bring it to your closing agent's attention right away and allow us the opportunity to get approved by that lender in advance of closing. So I am tabulate number 3 in your handout. And you will see that Alta Best Practices is identified and spelt out, and you can see that our manual was already signed off by our operating manager and available for review by the lenders upon request. The next handout is CFPB's outlining of what the lender will do and how they will go about making sure that they are working with qualified service providers. And that is the process I've been explaining to you, that we will be working with the lenders to become an approved closing officer. Lastly is one of the lenders actually stepping up and putting it to print, and that's SunTrust. SunTrust has been one of the leaders in identifying that they were going to take the position that they're going to be disclosing this CD, but they're going to be doing it with the cooperation of their closing officers, and then it will be available at the level that we're all working on that common platform together with. But they are taking the stance that they are going to expect that information at least 10 days in advance of closing, work days. They're identifying some of the procedures in which they're going to take in order to handle this in a streamlined procedure. So we wanted you to have this information available to you to realize that this is real. This is really coming down to us from so many points of view. And really and truly, until it's in place, it's not in place. But we're trying to identify and take in all the information that's being sent to us from so many different directions and putting it in some type of strategic fashion. And so that's what we're doing at Pioneer Title Services, to make sure we're approved for the vetting process and the certification process. Thank you.
A lot of information. Again, just so you know, we're not blowing smoke and making more out of this, is the real reason why we put into your handout here the letters that went out from Consumer Financial Protection Bureau a year or so ago, and using as an example SunTrust. This is for real, folks. And just as the lenders are now held to a higher standard, and are required to vet their title companies and all their vendors, but we're talking about title companies, I would suggest to you that just like they're doing, you too, as owners and operators of your business, should be aware of this, and you should be vetting your service providers, which include the title companies that you're working with, and to make sure that they're online, they're compliant. We have some lenders that are even parsing this out to certification companies that we have to deal with that give us certification. There's other lenders that are allowing us to self-certify, but it's for real, and it's something that you need to pay attention to as a way of talking to your agents that, hey guys, it's not the title company that brings you the best donuts, bagels, and coffee every day, but or for your sales agents, it's the people that know what they're doing and are appropriately certified, okay? So keep that in mind. Next, not dealing specifically with the changes that we're talking about, but also dealing with a topic that came out last year from the CFPB, is something that I wanted to bring to your attention because it's an opportunity or a potential exposure to liability on your part, and that's seller financing. And I've asked Kelly, who is our guru on seller financing. Kelly's not only a licensed title agent, but she's also a certified paralegal, to talk very briefly on seller financing, the restrictions on it, and the exclusions associated with it. We'll go through this briefly. There's much more to it than meets the eye. If nothing else, it just should raise red flags if you got a seller that's going to be taking back financing, or thought he was. Kelly?
Okay, I'm Kelly DeVore, and I'm going to be talking briefly about the seller financing. And as Mike said, last year, the new regulations came up from Dodd-Frank Act regarding the seller financing. And if you look at item 4 in your book, it has the FARBAR seller financing rider that many of you are probably already familiar with, but maybe you're not. We see a lot of contracts come through to our office that are for seller financing, but the realtors are not using this addendum. They're just putting it under the special clauses. And you really should be using this addendum because there are certain guidelines and exclusions that are listed here that are very important. Dodd-Frank is now regulating the seller financing. And if you look at that, there's exclusions. Most sellers will probably fit under the first exclusions, which is they have to be a natural person, estate, or a trust. And if they're just selling their property and taking back one mortgage in a 12-month period, and they own the property, they can sell or finance, but they can't be a builder or a contractor that constructed that residence, and they cannot have a adjustable rate mortgage unless it doesn't adjust for 5 years. So most sellers that do financing usually will fit under that exclusion. And then there's one other exclusion that would not require them to comply with the Dodd-Frank Act, and that would be if they're an entity and they finance 3 or less sales per year, per 12-month period. They still have to own the property that they're securing the financing, and they still cannot be the builder. They cannot have constructed the property. And they also have to do some due diligence with the borrower. They have to make sure that they have the ability to pay. So whether that's getting tax returns or pay stubs or bank statements, they have to do that. It cannot be an adjustable rate mortgage unless it doesn't adjust for another 5 years. But it has to be fully amortizing mortgage. It can't be a balloon mortgage. You know, you can't just have a balloon in 5 years. Those are the overview of the exclusions that are listed on that seller financing rider. And the big thing is it is recommended by Mike and the firm is that, you know, maybe you should go over this with your sellers that are considering doing financing at the listing stage so that they know, you know, up front that they fit within one of these exclusions, because if they don't, they would have to comply with Dodd-Frank, which means they could be considered a loan originator, and then they have to go through, they're basically are like a lender and have to go through all these hoops like the big banks do. Basically, if they don't fit within one of these exclusions, it's recommended that you have your client either meet with an attorney or a mortgage broker because the mortgage broker would know what they have to do to comply with those Dodd-Frank rules, and the attorney can also guide them through that. So we just wanted to make sure that all the realtors are understand that rider so that we can, you know, your client can understand at the beginning. And they may decide that they're, since they don't qualify for that exclusion, that they don't want to do seller financing because it's too much of a hassle to proceed with seller financing. And so basically, and from a liability point of view, you don't want to get to closing or after closing and the government is coming after your seller because they didn't comply with Dodd-Frank, and then they're coming after you and saying, well, you never told me this. So that's why it's good to use that FARBAR seller financing rider. And the penalties can be $5,000 per day per violation and $25,000 per day for reckless violations, and it can be upwards of that. So we just wanted to give you a brief overview of that and just a red flag if anybody is doing seller financing to either, you know, to carefully look at it and make sure you use this rider, the new rider that came out. I mean, it's not that new. It came out last September, so some of you are probably already using it. But we just wanted to make sure everybody is aware of the problems that could arise. And that's it.
Thank you,
everyone.
Now, the bottom line is, ain't that ridiculous? If you want to give your kid a mortgage so he can go buy a house, you can't do it. It's as simple as that. So it's just ridiculous on how over-regulated we are. However, it is what it is, and my caveat to you as a broker business, you're the broker, you're the owner. Somebody stubs their toe, they're looking at you, they're not looking at their agents. And the biggest thing with this is, one, go back to your office and make sure you got the right form, the most current rider that is compliant with the seller financing rules. And two, if you got a deal that you're writing that the seller is taking back seller financing, you should at least have a CYA letter that they need to talk to their attorney and consult their attorney before they close the deal and take back seller financing. That's the most poignant thing that I want to get across to you as a business owner. Okay, I'm trying to move as quick as I can. We're going to talk, my next topic is the FARBAR contracts. I'm going to, I'm assuming you're familiar with it. I'm assuming... And I'm assuming that you're using the most current forms. And FARBAR is just an acronym for the Florida Bar and the Florida Board of Realtors. And they have a joint program, and that's helped us tremendously over the years. That every, it's on a cycle, I think it's every 2 or 3 years they'll come out with changes. I'm not gonna go over it in detail. Time is running late. The tab is section 5. It talks about there's two sections in there. One, the changes that went into effect in 2014. I'm not going to talk about them. I'm assuming you're compliant with them. Very briefly, they did come out with proposed changes as a result of the new Consumer Financial Protection Bureau changes that we're talking about. And very briefly, I'm just going to, you can flip through them. The most important one is the extension of closing date. They put in here now that there's a provision in here for a one-time extension of your closing date if the delay is a result of consumer financial protection disclosure requirements. If your title company didn't get the information fast enough to the lender, if the lender didn't get the disclosure and has to go back and do it over again, it gives a one-time opportunity. So the moral of the story is make sure you're using the right damn form. Because if you don't have that exception in there, well then you gotta talk to your seller and you gotta talk to your buyer. All the rest of the changes that it talked about in terms of being compliant with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau changes, again, are dealing with that. We're talking about property inspections, We're talking about surveys, all of which is adding language in there to bring it into compliance and to provide for occurrences that may screw up your closing. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. It's there. If you have questions, if we can be of any assistance to you, please don't hesitate to call our office, either my law office or our Pioneer office. The next topic, real quick, is not related to this, but it's something that I'm very excited about, and is one of the gals that work in our law office, Aggie Mota. We've been fortunate. She's a certified immigration paralegal with 20 plus years of experience in New York, New Jersey, and here. We brought her on board. We have a full service immigration department now to provide for you. That's at tab 6. I'm not going to go into a lot of details. We provide all the things that the various types of easements, visas and things of that nature. We're well versed. Aggie is wonderful. You have any questions, any issues, you're dealing with foreign purchasers, foreign buyers, foreign sellers. Let me just say this. I went to a seminar just recently, about a couple weeks ago, on this very topic. Believe it or not, I mean, you see it. You're on the front lines. You know these people are pouring in here, buying up property. 80%, I couldn't believe it, 80% of the foreign investors are Chinese with between the ages of 28 and 40 years old. You believe it? So they're here, and I can attest to that personally because in my office, I have a good portion of it rented to a publicly traded company. So those are cap rate types of rentals. I've had just this year two serious different Chinese groups come in, look at the property, and make offers on it. So they're here. So what does that mean? Well, you're going to be dealing with foreign investors, foreign buyers, foreign sellers. Again, upgrade your professionalism. You can't expect your agents to know it all unless you know it and you educate them. And I just put together a little brochure. It talks about our immigration department. And then it says 5 things realtors need to know regarding their foreign real estate clients. Shame on you if you're not up to date on this. Shame on you if you don't pick up the phone and call me or call Aggie if you have somebody in your office and that you have some questions. We're glad to help you. Real quick, entity selection. How should they be taking title? I mean, you know, do we want to probate an estate for somebody in China? No. So we have alternative choices for them as to how they should take and hold title for the benefit of them and their family. There's significant income ramifications disposing of real estate, the FRIP, the withholding. There's estate and gift tax implications for foreigners. There's also exposure to income tax and income planning issues. We have on staff not only Aggie, who is our resident paralegal in immigration, but we also have on staff our tax attorney, who is well versed in international treaties. This is all governed by treaties. And then lastly is something that you may have heard but don't understand how powerful it is EB-5 visa requirements for foreign investors. Somebody coming in and want to plunk down $500,000 in an investment so that they can get a visa. Happens all the time. But there's strict requirements, strict regulations on how that works. So I just wanted to point that out to you, that we have that capability. Pass on one other thing. Pass on the good word to your contemporaries. We're the best kept secret in town. Now let's go, we're going to finish up. Let's go to tab 7. Now, tab 7, what does that mean to you? We want you. Now, I love you, glad to feed you, glad to give you something to drink, but I've never been bashful. I want your business. I want your business in our law firm, and I want your business in our title company. And why is that? Very simple, because we're the best there is. We have a firm belief we're the best you're going to find, not only in Flagler County, but also in our surrounding counties. If you take a step back, and we want you put that up on your bulletin board when you go back to the office. But if you go back in here, I want to introduce you to our staff. Michelle Heiser, 17 years of closing experience, managerial experience. U.S. Army veteran. And the 2000 vice chair of the affiliate committee with the Board of Realtors. Been very active. Kelly DeVore. Kelly's been with me since she was a kid. She went to school with Michael. I can guarantee, all of them, by the way, are licensed in the state of Florida, licensed title, agents and closing agents. All of them. You go talk to some of your people that you're dealing with and find out how many are really licensed. I guarantee you, you'll be surprised. Kelly is the best real estate paralegal in Volusia, Flagler, and St. John's County. What does that mean to you as a paralegal? It means that if you have questions, you have some concerns, you can call her, and to the extent that she's not giving legal advice, she's going to be able to answer your questions. Okay? So we got Kelly. And then Laura. Laura's claim to fame is I made her what she is. I gave her her first opportunity 40 years ago because she was Michael's babysitter. True story, right? So she babysat for Michael and my rest of my kids, and then she went on to there for an illustrious career in the title industry in Flagler County. She worked for many years with Palm Coast Abstract and Title, ITT's title company. From there, she went on to managerial and executive positions with First American Title, and we were so happy and fortunate to have her come back and join us in Pioneer. Laura handles most of our marketing and business development. Now, so with that said, why should you use Pioneer? And like I says, I'm not embarrassed to ask you that. And again, it's because we're the best there is. I am befuddled because I'm talking to you brokers as business owners and business entrepreneurs. I have been befuddled over the years of how, when I asked, well, who are you using to close your deals and why? Well, they're a friend of our neighbors, or they bring us coffee and donuts and bagels, or they're related to so-and-so, or they're a nice guy. I've never heard them say, because they're good. I've never heard them say that we trust them, we rely on them to get my deals, not the agent, my deals closed. Because I'm the bottom line. I'm the one that's paying the checks, the writing the checks, paying the bills, and don't get paid until the end. They're your deals, they're not your agent's deals, and I never could understand why brokers didn't exert a little more, how should I say, influence on their agents. It just doesn't make sense to me. And I'm sharing some of my frustrations over the years. The bottom line is you hire an accountant, why? Because he's related to your uncle? No, because he's good. You hire your IT guy, why? Because he's your sister's neighbor? No, because he's good. You hire a lawyer, why? Because they're good. But why wouldn't you hold your title closing agents to the same standard? I don't know. But I'm suggesting to you that the time has come. And the whole gist of this operation here was to help you as business owners understand that we're in a new dynamics. It ain't your father's Oldsmobile, the way they say that we used to close deals. You are the business owner. You need to take control back from your agents and saying, I've made the decision. These are the people that we're going to use. I think you would be wise to do so. So we appreciate your support and consideration. I'll have Laura be calling on you in sometime in the future to see if we can be of any assistance. Maybe we can start it off with a simple escrow agreement so we can handle your escrow accounts for you. But we'd be glad to do. Another reason. Not only are we the best closing title company in town based upon qualifications, but we're also supported by and affiliated with our law firm. And what does that mean? We have a number of lawyers in multiple disciplines that we're only too happy if you, your agents, or your customers have issues, have questions, need some help, direction, guidance. We're happy to do that because one hand washes the other. Common sense. So we're there to help you. Now, I think I put the strong arm on you enough of that now, okay? We're the best there is. Forget about the coffee. We're not going to bring you coffee. We're not going to bring you bagels. And we're not going to bring you donuts. We're going to bring you professionalism. We're going to bring you experience. And we're going to bring you service. Fair enough? So I want to hear from you. Now, with that said, I'm going to shut up. You've been very patient. I appreciate your attention. There's still food up here if you're hungry. There's still wine. There's still beer. But now I'm going to open it up for questions that any of you may have of any of us and just have a good old-fashioned get-together. Thanks. Yes, sir.
What happens on a cash deal?
Cash deal, business as usual. That what we're talking about only deals with residential and only deals with mortgages where there's a mortgage financing involved. Good question. Yes, sir.
Does the addendum for the seller financing entail residential and commercial?
No, just residential.
What if it's residential?
I'm sorry?
What if it's 6 units?
I think it's goes over into commercial once it's more than four, right?
1 to 4 is residential.
So over 4, we're okay, it's commercial?
Yes.
It would be outside of the loan originator rule, yeah.
Right. Something that wasn't discussed, and I think it's in Dodd-Frank's thing, that title insurance is optional for sellers.
I'm going to let Jay talk to that. It's confusing as hell. And this is a big, you're right. It's a good question. That's what Broker Symposium is all about. You guys are professionals, and that's a good question. Jay, can you talk about that?
I don't have all my diagrams. I'm going to lay out the whole distortion thing, but that's part of it. So they've done a few things regarding title insurance in the CD, which I think kind of evinces a little bit of mild skepticism about the title insurance industry. So yeah, owner's insurance is, because the lender's insurance is part of the loan package, and the whole CD is focused around the loan. Everything that's required for the loan, you know, gets a seat at the table and paid attention to. The owner's policy, they go out of their way to put it optional, has to be put in parentheses. Every title related charge has to say title and with a hyphen. So they identify that. And then there's the whole nasty thing you don't want me to go into where that we refer to, where if the seller is paying for the owner's title insurance, CFPB requires this distorted disclosure of what the cost is, where they kind of take advantage of the simultaneous issue rate to make it look like the owner's policy cost something other than what it really costs. It's kind of screwy. But you're right. Optional in parentheses is part of the CD form. It goes in front of the owner's title policy.
The whole program does not support itself. It supports the buyer.
Right.
They don't. Well, I would say yeah. They don't care.
So,
or they
so
don't care
I
about
imagine
the
you know if Florida this town fall, the Florida Real Estate Commission has its act together, let's say, what they should do on this, to me what they should do is allow a seller to stay in the house after the actual closing date, like I know it's in Ohio, and their contract says that the seller can stay in the house 30 days afterwards, because here, if anything changes on that new HUD, whatever you call it,
closing disclosure
form, that affects a trigger to reset the time. That's 6 days now, because if it's email or mail, it's actually 6 days.
At least.
So that's 6 days after that. Usually the seller has their moving company come there a day at a time. So now their sellers are screwed up. There's going to be a lot of issues here. And really, I think more emphasis should be talking to something that you might consider, Mike, is talking to these lenders that can't even get a package a day or two ahead of closing.
They've specifically said they're not gonna necessarily get that to the area.
Maybe you should have a little forum with the worst brokers here in town that can get their act together for once in their life.
Yeah, is there any accountability on the lender's part?
None. Right? Yeah.
Wait, accountability for what specifically?
Delayed closing, moving companies that are already scheduled, things like that.
Certainly that's not part of that. That's not part of Dodd-Frank. Yeah, I mean, it's all about lender's responsibility, but not so much their responsibility to the deal. It has to do with whether they've made these legally required disclosures to the borrower. It's all supposed to be to take care of the borrower and make sure they have time to think about their loan, that they're not tricked into signing something that they haven't had a chance to review. There's disclaimers about it, making sure that they understand that they can back out until they sign, all that type of thing. But is there anything else, anything put on the lender to make sure that they help the deal go through and help the other professionals? I don't think so. I don't think it's about that. It's they're trying to help the consumer borrowers.
Albert.
Is it possible that you could have a closing and just let it sit there for 6 days, everything gets done properly, and then record it? You got so many buttons to push.
No.
Need to put the cart
before the horse.
Right. If something's gonna go wrong, why wait for it to go wrong? Hold it in escrow and say, okay, here's your money, come back in 6 days.
Well, you gotta have to disclose yourself. And disclosures are dated. So if there's different timelines, if something happens, triggers a new, what's that thing you say, James?
Well, then, yeah,
CD, that if the timeline changes, then you can't close it.
You got to start over.
It's going to happen.
Yep. Yeah. Absolutely, it's absolutely going to happen, and it's just going to take a while to work through this whole system because nobody really has a firm handle on it. But the point I'm making and want to make to all of you is that it's your customers, whether it's the buyer or the seller, it's your customers that are going to get disgruntled. They're not going to get pissed off at me. They're not going to get pissed off at the title company or the bank. They're going to come back in your office and say, what the hell's going on? And that's why you need to be understanding of what is going on, understand the process. As Michelle said, be versant to be able to explain to them. We're going to have a letter going out on our, whenever we get an inquiry of a contract, we're going to have a CYA letter that basically talks about that the actual closing date is beyond our control, which it is, and that if they don't like it, to go talk to their broker.
We're getting a
reward. But no. I'm not going to say that. But
first half, Monday, you just have to
go. Yeah. No. I'm not going to say go to your broker, but we are going to have a CYA letter so that they understand that these are items that are totally beyond our control. And you should likewise have a CYA letter because you know what? Your clients are your best referrer of future clients. And if they unknowingly don't understand the process and you don't know enough to be able to understand it, that's part of your business, your better broker business.
All right, where's the culpability?
Pardon?
Where's the culpability?
Obama. All can decide, it's the feds. It's
Brian Frank, the other Frank.
Huh?
Brian Frank, the other Frank.
I think one was one and one was the other, really.
Really?
Yes, both Democrats.
Go figure.
Go figure.
Well, Don was really tight with the banks, though.
Thanks.
You have the banks to thank for some of the way it got handled.
Combined.
Yeah. Well, if you're using the CD, if it's a consumer loan, it's the early document is called the loan estimate, the LE. So it's the same. So the same kind of early requirements are in the LE. That's
those early numbers need to match.
Yeah, those numbers need to match.
That's all on the lenders, though. They have to make sure that, to the extent there's any difference between the CD and the earlier LE, that they're within certain requirements for variability, or they're in trouble, and they can get subject to fines and all that stuff. And that's all on them. They've got to get it right.
I'm telling you, it's unbelievable. Well, yeah. Repercussions that are going to come out of those things.
And that's, again, make sure you're using the right form that has a provision for an extension and closing. But it's yet, again, it's your business, and it's your responsibility and obligation to know what's going on and to train your agents. You know, there's an old saying, like trying to herd a herd of cats. I understand, but that's what you got to do. You got to educate your people. And for that matter, if there's anything that we can do, come to any of your sales meetings, we're happy to do it.
Mike, can you give us a list of the vendors that you are vetted with?
Pardon?
Can you give us a list of the vendors that you are vetted with?
Applied, is that the right word?
Mm-hmm.
So we're quote certified with most of the major lenders at this point in time, and we're continuing the process.
Correct. We're going to try to have something out by mid-July identifying all the lenders that we have been approved for.
The reason I ask that is, I think us as brokers, we need to go out there and actually interview some of these mortgage guys and say, hey, are you with the program or aren't you with the program? Because right now, most of them are not with the program today. So have them help us for tomorrow's program. We just need to see if we can get them on board. And, you know, it's our customers that we're sending out to these guys, referring them to them. If they're doing a disservice to our customers, that means we're not going to get a repeat customer out of them. So.
Well, you know, the interesting thing about that is a mortgage broker, some of them are actual lenders, and others are just brokers. And so, for instance, is if you have a mortgage broker that's a lender, they are very averse as to what's going on. And they are following the rules and the regulations about disclosure, and they're educating the agents along with us. And there's few that are doing it, but they are doing it because they understand the repercussions of not being in compliance. But a mortgage broker, on the other hand, does not wear the same hat as a lender does. And so we're not quite sure the approach a mortgage broker is going to take in all of this, and what role in actuality are they going to play in some of this, because a lot of it is disclosure and GFEs and TILA and RESPA. And so we're not sure how they're going to, what role they're going to be taking.
Not Frank, so do they have any idea on how they're working with the brokers or the lenders?
I haven't seen any true differential between identification of the role that a broker will play versus a lender. Only the lenders, the ones funding the loans. And so brokers are only brokers. And so it'll be interesting to see, since those are the ones providing the deal.
Yeah, I think generally speaking, when the federal regs talk about a creditor, they include brokers in there. I think it would depend it depend on the role the broker is playing,
right.
But they are responsible. Mortgage brokers are in there, not real estate brokers, mortgage brokers are in there with a responsibility for following the disclosure rules. If they're not doing that part, you know, then they're not going to be hung up on it, but they can very much fall under those requirements.
Yeah, so it would be good if we had some participation with everybody involved in the community.
I'm curious. Has the State Association, Board of Realtors, whatever you call it, have they gotten much information out to you guys on this?
Just from what you guys have been doing, just from what you guys have been doing for the Women's Council you guys have some classes coming out, I think, this month or next month?
Yeah, but every day in our newsletters, so we get plenty of information from.
I think we really, as a broker, I think we can have a broker roundtable at our association to discuss things like that. And, you know, I got one 2-3 weeks ago. We had a whole 14 brokers there out of 180. So that just goes to show you how much brokers really think about the association and moving their business.
No, on the Florida Realtors website, Margie has gone on a few times talking about the process and what's happening with this. It's about a 5-minute video, and there's also other short snippets videos on there that discuss it in not as in detail as we heard today. Thank you very much, Financial Jay. That's a lot of good information. But it's just in general, and we hope to at least pique your interest to go find out these things.
Do you think they would go forward with a broker roundtable?
Victoria, I know you've been working with some foreign investors. You see a lot of those coming into our community, and what are the opportunities that present itself?
A huge amount of opportunities. Everybody's flooding into Miami. You haven't even heard of our area, so I work really hard and have been for years to draw those people in. We've had one successful deal with Saudi Arabian. But again, it's just getting all our ducks in a row and placing our marketing to draw people in. Mm-hmm. They're running out of inventory in Miami and other areas, and nobody's heard of us. So it's working together to draw those investors up. There's plenty of them. So, you know, working together with companies like yours, and we've met before a couple of times, regarding the immigration and visas, now visas and supplies, and it's a focus we need to get back on.
Okay, any other questions we can help you with? Okay, well, there's still more food up there if you're hungry, and I appreciate it. Yes.
We'll come back tomorrow.